the city on the hill, said one old man to the other. It once shined bright and it would be shining still, but they all started turning on each other. See, the poets thought the dancers were shallow, and the soldiers thought the poets were weak, and the elders saw the young ones as foolish, and the rich man never heard the poor man speak. And one by one they ran away with their made-up minds to leave it all behind. And the light began to fade in the city on the hill, city on the hill. Each one thought that they knew better, but they were different by design. Instead of standing strong together, they let their differences divide. And one by one they ran away with their made-up minds to leave it all behind. And the light began to fade in the city on the hill, the city on the hill. And the world is searching still. But it was the rhythm of the dancers that gave the poets life. It was the spirit of the poets that gave the soldiers strength to fight. It was the fire of the young ones. It was the wisdom of the old. It was the story of the poor man that made it to be. That gives the poets life. It is the spirit of the poets that gives the soldiers strength to fight. It is the fire of the young ones. It is the wisdom of the old. It is the story of the poor man that's needing to be told. One by one will we run away with our made-up minds to leave it all behind. As the light begins to fade in the city on the hill.
I guess you heard enough, huh? Don't let your light begin to fade. You are that city on a hill. Christ says once that light come on, don't no man hide that light up under a bed or put a bushel on top of it. You know what I mean? Let that light shine. Good morning.
Good morning.
God bless you. Huh? You don't have to sneeze for somebody to say God bless you. Let us get up and greet one another, huh? You probably haven't even said good morning to each other all day. But get up and greet each other. Good morning. I do want to welcome our listening audience that's watching us over Ustream.tv. Those that's listening over Crusade Radio, I pray God would allow me to bless you with his word in this day. And I pray God would allow you to be a blessing to someone in this day. We're going to study this morning out of the book of 2 Timothy. The second book of Timothy. This is a letter that the Apostle Paul wrote to the young Christian Timothy. And Paul was quite fond of Timothy. In fact, he called Timothy his son. But this letter is more, when we interpret it, this letter is more written to young Christians which we are. We're always babes in Christ because every day you're going to learn something from the Word of God. 2 Timothy chapter 2. I'm going to read the first two verses of chapter 1. Right away, Paul identifies himself. Let us open in prayer. Father, we lift our voices to you, thanking you for that salvation we have through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Thanking you for the many blessings in our lives each day, Lord. Thanking you for each other. Thanking you, Lord, that we can learn from each other, teach each other, Lord, and praise you with each other, Lord, and search your word. I pray you would bless each individual here, those less fortunate than we are, Lord, those that are sick and shut in. Join with us now, Lord. Teach us, guide us in all truth. Open our ears, eyes, and hearts to the revelation of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. All these things we pray for in the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Chapter 1, verse 1, Paul identifies himself. Paul says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God. Now, we have to look at ourselves when he says, by the will of God. Because if you don't put God first, you're not doing it for God. And Paul knew it was a long time in his life before he put God first. Because God had to redeem himself to Paul. So Paul said, it's not that I really want to serve God, but when Jesus knocked him off that horse on the road to Damascus, Jesus told him to serve him. So Paul says, I'm doing this by the will of God, according to the promise of life. Because we know God tells us once we come to him, we are guaranteed eternal life. And Paul said, I'm doing this because I'm promised that life, which is in Christ Jesus. He says to Timothy, my dearly beloved son. Now he's calling him his son in Christ. Grace, which means salvation, because the Bible says it's by grace that you are saved, and the mercy of God, and the peace of God. Because we don't, you know, if you're talking about worldly peace, forget about it. You ain't got no peace. You got both of them men right now running for president, promising this, that, and the other, and they lying out of the side of their mouth, both of them. Neither one of them can accomplish everything that they stand in front of that TV and say. Not one of them. Because God is going to tell them, and he's already told them, who is in charge. You want me to give you a prime example of that? The last couple of weeks, they've been worried about all those states along the East Coast. God sent a storm through there and showed them who was in charge. They had to wait. Didn't neither one of them have a chance to go back there and campaign because God's showing them who's really in charge. They could fight all they want to. God's in charge. See, we're not to get tied up in these things of the world. I don't care who's president. I'm going to do what God say. No matter what they say, and no matter what laws they want to pass, I'm going to do what God say. They don't like it too bad. Grace, mercy, and peace from God, the Father, and Christ Jesus, our Lord. Our Lord. Not President Obama or President Mitt Romney. Jesus Christ, our Lord. There's a scripture in this chapter here going to tell you the same thing. Chapter 2, there's a scripture going to tell you the same thing. And I'm going to point it out to you when we get to it. Chapter 2, verse 1. Thou. Now, I just told you that Paul was talking to Timothy because he's a youngster in Christ. And now he's also talking to you because we are all babes in Christ. No man can pick this Bible up every day. I don't care how much of a Christian he is. No man can pick this Bible up every day and read it and say he didn't learn something new. Every day you pick this up, You learned something new. So that shows you you are still a babe in Christ. Thou, therefore, my son, be strong in that grace that God has had on you. That's grace that's in Christ Jesus. Be strong in your salvation. This is what he's saying, because the Bible says it's by grace you are saved. So be strong in that salvation that you have. No man can take that away from you. No man should be able to take that away from you, what you believe. And in the things, Paul says, also be strong in the things that you've heard about me. Now, if you read the gospel, you've heard a lot of things about Paul. You read the book of Acts, you read a lot of things about how Paul stood around and when his name was Saul and held the coats of those men that threw stones at Stephen. Then you'll read about Paul, how he was on the road to Damascus to lock Christians up. Paul said, be strong in those things that you've heard about me. And those things you've heard about me is that once I didn't love God, but now I do. So be strong in those things, because at one time we probably didn't love God either, but now we do. So be strong in those things that you've heard about me. And the same thing that you're strong in, commit to other men. Tell other men about it. Hey, I used to be just like you. Tell other men, I used to be like you. And tell them how God saved you. And let them know God will save them. But tell those to men that can tell other men. And in all things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men. Men that you know are going to be faithful in what you tell them. And they shall be able to teach others. Thou, therefore, you, since you know at one time you denied God, and now you know that God has forgiven you, therefore endure. Hold on to what God has given you as a good soldier for Christ Jesus. I know how rotten I used to be. Huh? If I could only be twice as good as a Christian as I was a sinner. Yeah. Just think about that. Yeah. You know how bad you was in your sin, right? If only you could be. So Paul is saying, be strong in that what you have as a good soldier for Jesus Christ. Now, verse 4. I told you this verse was coming up. Remember I was talking about the president and Mitt Romney? We're not to get tied up in this world, in this stuff that's going on. Let these elections and things bother us. Look what it says in verse 4. No man that war. No man that in wars entangles himself in the affairs of this life. See, I'm too busy having a spiritual war. I'm too busy trying to fix that me. I ain't got time to be worried about fixing what's going on in the world. No man that's trying to get right with God has any business worrying about what's going on around him. You trying to get right with God. No man entangles himself with the affairs of this life. I'm worried about afterlife. I'm too busy worrying about getting right for that next life. I ain't worried about what's going on here. If you were too much worried about this, where's your standing with God? You think you fixed enough that you don't have to do nothing else to yourself? No, you still got to work on you. The Bible tells us very clearly, we will see him as he is, then we will be like him. So until then, you're not to be bothered with the affairs of this life. Now, we're to be salt of the earth. We're supposed, but you're still warring within yourself with that spiritual you. You got to fix you. Yes.
I'll tell you that in Revelations 2, you know, it says, all those bad things, it's not for us.
Yeah, it's not for us. It's not for us. We don't care about this world. We're just passing through. We're just visitors. We're just passing through. Worldly people worry about this world. No man that wars entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him that has chosen him. See, I worry about fixing me so I can please God. I'm not worrying about fixing the world so the world could please God, because the world don't love God. The Bible says, yet while we were in our sin, Christ died for us. And there's some that's still in their sin that Christ died for, but they still will not accept him. Still will not accept him. So who are you to make people believe when God can't make them believe? You get yourself right with God. And if any man strive for masteries, verse 5, yet he is not crowned except he strive lawfully. Anything that you're trying to do, you're not going to accomplish it unless it's by the will of God. That's lawfully. Unless it's by the will of God. Now look what it says here in verse 6. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 6. The husbandman, which is God, that labors must be first partaker of the fruit. What does it mean by that? The husbandman must be first partaker of the fruit. You must put God in front of anything that you do. God first. God first. If you're going out there to do something for somebody, Lord, go before me. God first. You must be doing it for the will of God, not for you. God first. He must be partaker of whatever it is that you're getting ready to do first. Verse 7, Paul says, think about what I'm saying to you. Consider what I say. And pray that God gives you understanding in all things. That you'll understand no matter what you do, it's got to be for God. And God got to be first in whatever it is that you do. See, girl, I'm going to tell you one reason why the scripture says that. One reason why it says that is because it tells you very clearly pride. You will put on pride if you think you did something for yourself. See, I know I was addicted at one time. I was a drug addict. And I went to NA and AA and all of that, and they couldn't fix me. But when I asked God, put God first, it got fixed. See, because if NA or AA would have fixed me, I would have been running around here bragging. Or if I had to fix myself, I would have ran around here bragging. But God had to do it. God had to be first partaker of that fruit. And the fruit was getting clean. God had to be first. Remember, verse 8, that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead. Paul said, according to my gospel, according to the good news that I believe in, he was first. You think anybody was going to raise from the dead before Jesus Christ? Even though Jesus walked down to the grave of Lazarus and raised Lazarus from the dead, do you know Lazarus didn't get to heaven before Jesus?
He was at rest.
Because you can look back at that story where that rich man was in hell, and you find out Lazarus wasn't in heaven. He was at rest. Verse 9, 2 Timothy. Chapter 2, Paul says, wherein I suffer trouble as an evildoer, which is each and every one of us, even though we've gone to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we go through the same thing the evil person goes through in this life. And you know what that is? Temptation. Temptation. Wherefore I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bonds. And those bonds are temptations. Anything that holds you away from God or holds you down is a bond. Yet, Paul says, when I look at the word of God, I'm free. I'm free. No matter what those temptations are around me, when I look toward what God says, I am free. Verse 10. Therefore, I endure all things for the elect's sake. Paul said, everything I go through it so people can look at me, those that are chosen by God, and say, well, if Paul went through that, I can go through it too. If Paul denied God at one time, I know I did too, and God forgave him. I can go to him. I can go to God and be forgiven too. Because Paul said, I know why God forgave me. And the same thing that we can say, we know why God forgave us, because of our ignorance. Because we were ignorant towards God at the beginning. We didn't know how much we needed God in our lives, but once we come to realize that, God forgives us. Paul says, so I go through everything I go through for the elect's sake, for those that God has chosen. There's some sitting now on the bus stops. There's some behind dumpsters right now that God is calling. And there's some of us that used to be in the same places. And we went through all those things in those same places so that those that's behind those dumpsters and behind those on those bus stops right now can look at us and say, hey, you used to be over here with us. Now look at you. God can forgive you. I'm quite sure God can forgive me. There are a lot of people that come over here every day to get fed. I'm quite sure that look at you. Those of you that are here, and get encouragement. That's what they're supposed to do. They get encouragement, but they're just not ready. See, because God's going to make his presence known unto you, but he's not going to grab you around the collar. You have to submit. They're just not ready. How many times, how long it's going to take, God knows already. The Bible says you are predestined. So God knows the exact time, the exact place. Paul says in verse 9, wherefore I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bonds, but the word of God is not bound. Therefore I endure all things for the elect's sakes, that they may also obtain salvation, which is in Christ Jesus with eternal life. See, because somebody can look at you and say, I used to know him. We used to do things together. But we don't do them anymore. And they can look at you and see the things that know the things that you've gone through with them and know how you come out of it, and they can come the same way that you came. Same way that you came. There's a lot of people you can go to some of your old stomping grounds. A lot of people say, what happened to you? what happened to you? You look young. You look different. Verse 11. It is a faithful saying. It is a faithful saying that if we be dead with Christ, we shall also live with him. Amen. See, because when you can get up there and go down in that baptismal pool, because your friend's sitting here next to you and you want them to see you get baptized. But when I go back there and let all that water out, your sin ain't going down that drain. But if you get in there and you rise in newness of life, if you've truly accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, from that moment on, he enters into you. You have died. That's what baptismal shows, that you have died and you rise in newness of life. So if you die with him, if you go down in that water already confessing Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior, when you rise, there's a new, you're rising with him. There's a newness in life. So if you die in Christ, you shall also live with him. Now, I'm going to tell you something else, too. There's a lot of people that are dead, that say they believed in Jesus Christ before they died, and were liars. But do you know the Bible tell you all will rise? Every one of us will rise. Those that died with Jesus Christ, believing in Jesus Christ, and those that didn't, all will rise. Yeah, some's going to take the bus and some's going to take an L train. Huh? See, but when Christ comes back, boy, this is such a glorious picture. When Christ comes back, those that died in Christ are going to be the first ones to rise. You're going to see Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. You're going to see John the Baptist. You're going to see all of them coming up. Then, the Bible says, we which are walking around on the face of the earth, we which remain, that believe in Jesus Christ, the Bible says this spirit goes back to him that gave it to us. These bodies falling down. And we're going to be caught up with them in the air. You know, the Bible also talks about two judgments in the book of Revelation. It said if we died in Christ, we're going to rise with him. So when he comes back, he's taking his. And the whole entire book of Revelation, every plague in there, everything that's bad in the book of Revelation belonged to those that did not rise with Jesus Christ. Now they're going to see us going. And then it says that they will not stand in the judgment of the righteous. They're going to be judged separate from us that be judged. We're going to be judged with our salvation. What did you do with what God gave you? Did you tell somebody else about Jesus Christ? Believe me, you're not going to be judged because you were once a sinner. Because now, even though you're a sinner now, you're a redeemed sinner now. You're a forgiven sinner now. You're still a sinner, but you're a saved sinner. You're not going to be judged for your sins because you confessed and said, Lord, forgive me. And the Bible says he removed them. So he's not going to judge you for them, but he's going to judge you for what you did with your salvation. You want to complain about abortion? Then you better go down there to the polling place and vote for somebody that don't believe in abortion. Don't stand there in front of God and say, Lord, why did you let them kill? You had the power to vote them. That's what you're going to be judged for. But those that died without Jesus Christ, they're going to die in their sin. And they're going to rise and they're going to be judged separate. It is a faithful saying. For if we be dead with him, we shall also live with him. If we suffer, we shall reign. And nobody ever told you, nowhere in the Bible does it tell you it's easy being a Christian. Nowhere in the Bible. You suffer. You suffer even when you don't think you're going to suffer. I suffer the fact that I got relatives that don't know Jesus Christ. And they don't want to believe me when I tell them about Jesus Christ. Christ had the same problem. Christ had the same problem with some of his own very disciples. Peter denied him. He suffered too. And the Bible teaches you very clearly, you are not greater than your master. So if he suffered, so will you. So will you. If we suffer with him, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny you. If we believe not, if we believe not, yet he is faithful. He cannot deny himself. Now, ain't no way God is going to compromise with you. Either you believe or you don't. Now, ain't no way you're going to say you believe in God and don't do godly things and think that God is going to accept you. God is true. And God is not going to accept anything that's false. So if you're a fake Christian, don't think that God's going to accept you. That's not going to happen. God is true. God say, these people draw close to me with their mouth. These people run around here saying, yeah, they love me, and yeah, they love me, and they don't do anything that I tell them to do. God is not going to accept that. God is not going to accept any pastor that stands behind that pulpit or any pastor that stands in these big cathedrals and don't teach you the entire word of God. All of it, even when it makes him stand up there and feel convicted. Because if he don't feel convicted, he don't have the spirit of God. He think he's bigger than God. You know Moses talked to God face to face? Face to face? And God told Moses, no, you can't see my glory because my glory is truth. And my glory will tell you who the true you is, and it will kill you. See, because no way Moses could have stood there and thought he didn't need God. Moses would have found out, even though he was glowing like a candle, he needed God too. he needed God too. If we believe not, yet he abide faithfully, he cannot deny himself. Of these things, put them in remembrance. Paul say, don't forget about these things. Charging them before the Lord that they strive not about words to no profit. Don't argue about the word of God. You don't have time to argue about the word of God. What are you getting out of it? People are going to take things away from you when you argue about the word of God. They keep on arguing about it. Sooner or later, they're going to convince you to believe them. It ain't going to profit you nothing. Don't argue about the word of God. The word of God is as it is. Because if you're arguing about the word of God, it destroys the hearers. Because you're going to start listening to something that somebody else is telling you. Study to show yourself approved unto God, not unto men. Because men want you to do what they want you to do. Do what God tells you to do. A workman that need not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Study yourself to be approved in God's eyes, discerning what is true and what is not true. Because the Bible teaches you, God gives you that spirit of discernment. God gives you that spirit of discerning, and God tells you when you're listening to something that is not his word. Not his word. Paul says in verse 16, you know what the truth is. You know when somebody teaching you what God says. You know what's important about that? Because there's a scripture in the Bible that says this about people that's teaching the word of God. No scripture. Now, it plainly tells you no scripture is of any private interpretation. No scripture. You can't take a scripture out of the Bible and build your religion on it and say this is it. You got to take the whole word of God. Not one scripture. The whole word of God. Paul says, When you run into people like that, run away. Shun from profane and vain babblings. For they will increase unto more ungodliness. They will start writing their own books about the Bible. They'll take one scripture and say, this is in the Bible. Then they want to write their own Bible and write other things and write books about the Bible instead of reading the Bible. Oh, you got some religions got their own Bibles. You got some religions that put 6 more books to the Bible. Paul says, shun away from those things because they will lead you into more ungodliness. Who concerning the truth, concerning what the real word of God is, they have made mistakes. They have erred. Because when they go taking one scripture and then the next thing you know, they're going to say the scripture means this. And then that scripture means this and that scripture means this. Because they only took one scripture instead of the whole entire Bible. Do you know how much the Old Testament compares with the New Testament? The same. If you got a King James Version especially, you can look at one scripture and it'll tell you to go back to the Old Testament and look at another. It's the same. It's the same. God ain't saying nothing to man today that he didn't say yesterday. He ain't saying nothing to you he didn't say to your grandfather. He didn't say nothing to you that he didn't say to Adam. I'm going to prove it to you. One scripture. God is not saying anything to man today that he did not say to Adam in the Garden of Eden. God today tells man, come. Today, God says to man, come. In the book of Genesis, the first time God called man, God said, Adam, where art thou? Same thing he says to man today, come. Adam hid himself. God said, where art thou? He called Adam from the beginning, and he is calling man today. Come. Same exact thing. God has not changed. The Old Testament and the New Testament. Same exact thing. In the Old Testament, God called man. In the New Testament, God is calling man. Paul says in verse 16, shun away from those vain babblings. Because they lead to more ungodliness. And their word will eat as a canker, as a worm eats. Paul says in verse 18 that they have erred, saying that the resurrection is past already. Saying that Jesus ain't coming again. They made a mistake when they say that. They make a mistake when they say Jesus been here already and he ain't coming again. The Bible speaks about a second coming all through the whole entire Bible. One scripture says, this earth and these heavens are going to pass away. And he's bringing a new Jerusalem. So he's got to rise again. He's coming again. Who concerning the truth have erred, saying the resurrection is past already, and overthrow the faith of some. They make some people believe that Jesus is not coming again. See, some people think you eat, drink, and be merry because all you do is live for today. That's a mistake. Nevertheless, the foundation of God stands sure. Those that belong to God are sure in what they believe in. The foundation of God stands sure. Having this seal, the Lord knows them that are his. God knows them that are his. And those that belong to God know if they belong to God too. See, you don't have to go around and ask somebody else, am I a Christian? You don't have to go around and ask somebody else, am I a Christian? What did he say right then? Those that the Lord knows them that are his. And there's a scripture in the book of Matthew that tells you the same thing. Here it says, God knows those that are his. There's a scripture in Matthew that tells you if you know God too. Christ says, my sheep hear my voice. So you already know if you believe, if you belong to God already. God knows if you belong to him, but you also should know if you belong to God. Christ says, my sheep hear my voice. No matter what somebody else tell you to do, you know if God don't want you to do it because you hear him. And let everyone that name the name of Christ, everyone that calls himself a Christian and swear by the name of Jesus Christ, depart from evil. Depart from evil. But in a great house there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but also of wood and earth, and some honor and some dishonor. In one house, in the house of the Lord, there's not only those that are truly God's, there are some that do a work of God. There are some that preach the word of God. There are some that do the work of God. And there are some that are wood. There are some that say they love God and don't even know the difference. There are some that know God's in their life and don't pay God no attention. They're wood. But God still loves them. God still loves them. If a man, therefore, clean himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified, set aside to meet the master, set aside and meet and necessary for God to use. Necessary for God to use and prepared unto every good work. If you run away from those that are not, that are planned church, planned Christians, then God is calling you out. He's setting you aside and making you necessary to work for him. Because those that's faking church and faking Christians, what does it say? God can't deny himself. God don't want no part of them. He don't want no part of them. So today, we all need to search ourselves and find out what our true relationship with God is. Flee also youthful lust and follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace with them that call on the name of the Lord with a pure heart. What does it mean by flee from youthful lust? We were born sinners. Flee from sin. We were born sinners. And when we were born sinners, all we did was chase things of the world. Yes. That was in your youthful lust. But when you came to know our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, you should have graduated into an age of maturity. To know the value of who you are and what you are and what you mean to God. And put off that youthful lust. Put that off. Verse 23. but foolish and unlearned questions. Because there's a lot of people going to ask you some stupid stuff when you go to God. A lot of people. And the reason why they ask you is because they are without the knowledge of God. They don't know God. You know, there's a lot of things that God will open your eyes to once you come to him. You can look back and say, oh, yeah, God was there. God had to be there. Because if God wasn't there, I wouldn't have got through that. But before you come to God, you don't know that. You think it's I, and me. But the foolish and unlearned questions avoid, knowing that they do grow arguments. They do gender strife. Foolish questions. That's all they do is stir up strife. Somebody want to ask you, how do you know God forgave you? Because I asked him. How you want to say, I know all the things we did. God came. I asked him. That's a foolish question. But don't argue about it, because it's only going to lead up to a bigger argument. That's because they don't know God. That's why they asked you that question. And the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men and able to teach them patience. Able to teach them how to wait on the Lord. In meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves. Because that's what the evil man does. He fights against himself. Don't even know that he's really fighting against himself. What did the Bible say earlier? We that have come to Christ, we're too busy striving within ourselves to fix ourselves than to be worried about matters of this world. But men of this world don't know that their spirit is stirring inside of them. Because the Bible teaches you, your spirit is willing to serve God, but your flesh is not. And men that are still living in the flesh, they're going to fight with the spirit. All the time, they're going to have a fight with that spirit. Instructing those that oppose themselves. If God peradventure will give them repentance to the knowledge of the truth, pray that God will forgive them and open their eyes to what the truth is, and that they may recover themselves out of the trap that they're in, the trap that the devil has set for them. See, because none of us, all of us are born sinners, and we're already trapped when we're born. And until God awakens up, we're going to stay in that trap that Satan has set for us. And that trap is loving the world. Loving the world. But pray for those that have not come out of that, that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who will take captive by him at his will. And Satan will capture you if you allow him. If you allow him. I pray God has blessed you. I pray your eyes are open to some things that will help you in your relationship with God. The important thing is that you have a relationship with him. Today is the day of your awakening. Brenda, will you close us in prayer, please? Here.
Father God, I just come to you right now, Lord, and I thank you for everything that you're doing in our lives all around us, Father God. The miracles I see every day and the people that I have known in the past are here with me, Father God, and their lives have changed, and I thank you for that, Father God. I bless everybody here, those that are without you, Father God. I ask that they come to know you and love you like we do, Father God. And all these three things we pray for, amen. I pray for my cold.
Take God with you.